Okay, so all of you read about, of course, our speaker today, and that's why you're here. He's internationally famous, and he's in great demand throughout the country and to organizations like our own. And we're just delighted to have him, and we're just fortunate that we could work out the timing that he could be here just when we had a good opportunity to bring him in. He will be talking about probably everybody's favorite topic, sex and humor. And he keeps the humor associated with the sex part and shows us how I think the church tries to put a guilt trip on us for being human. So I think it's going to be a fun thing. He comes with great credentials and great accolades from other talks he's given. He's a psychologist, and he also had a master's degree so that he could go out and preach the gospel. And he right around that time realized that he had lost his faith. And so he gave up that part of it, but he's then formed, of course, this group called the Recovering from Religion Group. He saw a need because he was in a very family that was very, very much religious. And so he was brought up that way and thought that that wasn't going to work for him anymore. And so he saw the need for a group such as that. So you'll hear a little bit more about that. We have Lisa Barge back there who is passing out information about the group. So if you feel like you need a little help adjusting to your new lifestyle away from religion, that's a great place to go. He will be signing books in the back. He already has been signing books. But after the speech, you'll be there, and then we'll go to the cafeteria afterwards, and we can do a little socialization there. If you want to hang around, it's always a nice time to get better acquainted with people of like mind and thought. So without further ado, I'm going to bring on Darrel Ray. Give him a big hand.
Ah, it works. Great. Well, good morning. This is about the earliest I ever get up. Or I don't get up on Sunday mornings. That's the beauty of being an atheist. I don't have to get out.
Is this working? Yeah. Oh, yeah, it's working now. Okay. All right. Well, I used to be a bit of a preacher, so I don't stay behind that thing. And I like to kind of interact with my audience. I got to meet a bunch of people here today, and man, you've got a vibrant community here in Tucson. I'm loving it. So let's get in here. I want to give you some, first of all, I want to thank Jerry and the Free Thought Arizona and Diane and other people who've helped me put this on. I know how much effort it takes to get these kinds of events to come off successfully. And man, we got a great attendance here for this morning. I am happy to announce that just 2 days ago, The God Virus came out on audiobook. And Sex and God will come out on audiobook sometime after the first of the year. So that's just kind of a quick thing. We've already talked a little bit about recovering from religion, but I want to emphasize it a little bit more. We are a 501c3. We have 55 or more meetup groups, groups that are meeting all around the country in the United States, and we're in five other countries in the world, including Great Britain, India, Australia, Canada. And these are groups that come together once a month to deal with the problems of leaving religion. And, you know, quite frankly, I love atheist groups, I love free thought groups, but they've been there and done that. They don't want to hear people's story about, you know, what do I do with my still religious husband, or what do I do with my kids? I raised them religious and now I'm not anymore. That's what this group is all about. And I saw so many potential members of our movement coming to our meetings and then never coming back because they weren't ready to talk about Darwin. They weren't ready to talk about nuclear physics or, you know, astronomy. They were still hurting from the emotional trauma of leaving their religion. They needed a safe place to land. So that's why I started 3 years ago recovering from religion. And I think you guys had Jerry DeWitt here, did you not? Recently, Jerry's the executive director of Recovering from Religion. He's been running it for the last year. I started 3 years ago and turned it over to him. And Sarah Moorhead, who's our assistant director out of Omaha. And they've done a fantastic job because our organization has grown dramatically. So I would like you to consider, if you become a supporter of us, where we need donations, because we've got lots of things we want to do with this organization. And we think we are bringing thousands of people into the movement that would probably not show up at one of your meetings, but they will show up to one of our meetings. And they usually stay about 3 or 4 months, and then they move on. That's a problem with we're not an AA. We don't keep you forever like the Alcoholics Anonymous does. We keep you as long as you need, because when you are recovered, go join the free thought movement. Go join an atheist group. Join a skeptics group. We don't care. We don't want to trap you forever. So that's what recovering from religion is. And then last, the Secular Therapist Project. How many of you are familiar with the Secular Therapist Project? Oh, not very many people. Okay. You may have, if you got online right now and tried to find a therapist that wouldn't send you back to church, or tell you had to pray more, or get your chakras realigned, it would be hard to find that kind of a therapist. And right now, Pat Robertson's university, Regents University, is graduating PhDs in psychology. You can get a PhD in psychology and go do therapy on poor suckers who don't know that your degree is from a university founded by a man that thinks God sends hurricanes to punish cities. And they require a year. Pat Robertson's university, Regents University, requires a year of theology, Pat Robertson theology, before you can get that PhD. There are now hundreds of religious schools graduating counselors, marriage and family counselors, psychologists, social workers, who are fundamentally religious, and their main goal in life is proselytizing. So we have set this new system up. It's a very sophisticated website that's free to use from the therapist side and free to use from the client side. We guarantee you will find a secular therapist through us. If you find a therapist through us, we're not everywhere, but we've got 88 counselors and therapists register with us now, and over 700 clients register with us. So if you're looking for a good therapist, look at us first. If you are a therapist, register with us first. And just because you register doesn't mean you get in. We have to, 4 of us secular therapists will screen you. We want to make sure you are secular. We don't want any woo-woo stuff coming in or any Baptists slipping under the carpet. All right. And last, these are all interesting things that are going on right now. I don't know if you've seen the American Humanist Association has just launched this week a new Kids Without God website and Teens Without God website, and it's got tremendous resources. If you are a parent, if you are a grandparent, you should go to this site and explore it. Explore it with your children or with your grandkids. It's got all sorts of cool stuff. Bill Nye, the science guy, is in there, and evolutionary stuff, and science experiments you can do with kids. It's really well done. I am so thrilled that when they announced it, it looked like a finished product. I mean, they put a lot of time and money into this website, it looks to me like. And I am they've got me doing the Ask an Atheist. So I am now answering 13-year-old questions about what do I do with my parents who want me to go to church. And I thought, oh, that's a cool idea. I'd like to help you with that. But it's turned out to be a little more difficult than I thought. Answering 13-year-old questions. It's been a while since I was a 13-year-old. Okay, so that's kind of the preliminaries. Let's get down to the serious business. There was a lady back there that forgot to give me the $5. I was betting, but we'll see if she owes me $5. We're going to say a prayer, folks. Where's our Pastafarians? Pastafarians? Very good. You guys have to bow your heads. The rest of you can pretend like you're religious or something. All right. Dear Flying Spaghetti Monster, we thank you for giving us sex and sexuality, whether homo or heterosexual, bi or trans, and for not making us like those uptight Christians, Muslims, and Baptists. We thank you for wonderful masturbatory fantasies, and for the pornography upon which they're often based. FSM, we ask that you grant us sex partners, lovers, wives, husbands that know where our G-spot, our clitoris, and the sweet spot on our penis is. Grant us long, loving foreplay with deep, wet kisses, followed by huge orgasms and loving cuddles after. Grant us the courage and wisdom to communicate openly and honestly with our partners and give them more pleasure than we receive, for we know it is far better to give than to receive. Your noodliness, we do not need 72 virgins. In fact, we ask that you send us no virgins, for we don't want to have to train them. Unless, of course, they're very willing to be trained. We especially plead today that you not send us any repressed Christian virgins, male or female, for they will only feel guilty and cause great problems with their abstinence-only training. Your abstinence, we ask that you give us the wisdom to understand and appreciate our partner's kinks or lack thereof. Whether foot worship or spanking, ropes or talking dirty, help us to appreciate their full sexuality and lead us not into temptation or judgment and scorn of those of others when their sexual preferences are not ours. We do ask in the name of Ramen for retribution, shame, scorn, and scorn on pedophile priests, hypocritical ministers, sleeping with a choir director, and gay-bashing closeted ministers, etc. Oh, SpaghettiO. We ask that you send condoms and birth control in abundance and your blessings to the many dedicated workers at the Trojan Condom Factory and Planned Parenthood. In the name of Dan Savage and Greta Christina, we pray for they are the true gods and goddesses of this world. Do I hear ramen? There we go. Ramen. All right. Thank you, folks. We may have gotten some converts there. All right. Now, I do have a rule. I enforce it rigidly, and that is you will laugh at my jokes, whether you like them or not. And you're doing all right so far. So we're going to get serious here, and we're going to cover a wide range of ideas. And when we're finished, I'll be happy to answer questions at the end, and when we go out to eat, happy to interact with folks as well. But my first serious question is, do you masturbate? I do. How many of you masturbate? Ooh, there's a lot of liars in this group. A lot of liars in this group. Yeah, isn't that interesting? We're still a little, here we are, atheists or secularists or skeptics, and we're still afraid to admit what everybody knows we do. I studied with the great psychotherapist Albert Ellis, and he had a saying. He said, thank you. I have a story to tell you about him later, but I won't tell you today. He had a famous saying that 97% of all men will admit to masturbating and 3% are lying. We know now that 80% of women masturbate and the other 20% are probably lying. That's probably not true. Women don't masturbate as much as men probably, but they still do. And the sex toy business has done really well, and you've noticed the Shades of Grey is selling hot like hotcakes, as poorly written as it is. So can you imagine me asking that question at this very time on a Sunday morning in a Catholic church? Or how about a Baptist church or a mosque, Muslim mosque? No, there would be no hands go up. And they're all lying, are they not? If you don't raise your hand, well over 95% of all humans have probably masturbated at some point in their life. And if they didn't raise their hand, they're lying. And religious people lie all the time, especially about their sexuality. And that masturbation is actually a biological imperative. And we will come back and find out why it is so important for both males and females of our particular species. Now I'm going to begin by looking at our bodies. There's evidence of evolution throughout our entire bodies. From everything from your breasts, and I mean men and women's breasts, the shape of the penis, the shape of the vagina and clitoris, the chemistry of the semen, and the chemistry of the vaginal fluid. Even, ladies, down to the sounds you make while you're having orgasm, that is evolutionary. How many of you have read Sex at Dawn? Anybody read the book Sex at Dawn? Okay, it's the second best book on sex ever written. I'll give you a guess what the first best one was, but it's a very good book. Read it after you read mine, okay? Viscosity of the semen and the composition of sperm. But you know, all of this, our Pope seems fairly unaware of how human sexuality has evolved in us and who we are as human sexual creatures. And since this is Arizona, and I know there's so many good Mormons in this state, I thought I would include Thomas Monson in as well. For those of you who don't know, he's the Pope of Mormonism. And he has never masturbated in his life. And he is partially responsible for every 12-year-old Mormon boy getting a pamphlet that says, "Don't tamper with the factory." Guess what that's all about? All right. All right, well, let's get in here. We're going to start right at the very beginning. Sex organs. That's what you came here to hear about, sex organs. Sex organs are the most rapidly evolving component of any sexual creature on this planet. This is the man who studied sex organs more than anybody else, and he got called a pervert because he was studying sex organs all the time. Carl Linnaeus, he created the classification system that we use even today, the two Latin terms that you see for almost every species. And he was studying these kinds of sex organs. This is a sex organ. This is a sex organ. This is a sex organ. And so is this a sex organ. So all these sex organs are evolving very rapidly, and these are flowers. Flowers are evolving in response to competition among their own species, competition with other species. Who are the insects available to pollinate? The soil, the temperature, there's all sorts of pressures on flowers to evolve. And the sex organs are the flowers are the sex organs of the plant. And even plants that are really, really closely related can have vastly different sex organs. Think about orchids. I went to an orchid, I don't know what you'd call it, garden one time in Panama, and they had 200 different orchids there. And these are species that are very closely related. And I dare say not any two of those had anything that looked alike. Orchid flowers can be remarkably different, and yet they're still very closely related to each other. So that shows us how fast flower sex organs are evolving. Let's look at animal sex organs. Animal sex organs are evolving really fast as well. And the first animal I want to talk about is a little animal called the Argentine bluebill, who is the John Holmes of the animal world. Now, those of you who know what I just said, your minds are in the gutter here. Yeah, you know who John Holmes is, so that tells me a whole lot right there. Well, the Argentine bluebill is a little duck with a big, very big member. Now, for those of you who don't like pornography, close your eyes, or you might want to leave right now, but we're going to see some duck pornography. And I'm going to show it to you twice just to really get you going. I've had people say they couldn't sleep for three nights after they saw this video. But watch it very carefully and see what we've got going on here with the ducks. This is slowed down 10 times. This is a duck penis coming out, slowed down 10 times. Now watch carefully. Boop. There we go. All right, let's look at it again. Have fun here. Duck porn. Thank you, light guy. Boop. All right. Thanks for turning the lights down. I can put it back up now. All right, so that's interesting. Guys, that look like yours? No, it sure doesn't look like yours. Doesn't look like mine either. Some interesting thing about birds, only 3% of all birds actually have penises. 97% don't have penises. They reproduce in other ways. But even these birds who do have penises do not run it off of the blood pressure system. They run it off of the lymphatic system. So that's a lymph system going on there. That tells us that their sexually reproductive system goes way, 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 way back. Probably, maybe even to the dinosaurs. Maybe dinosaurs ran their penises off of the lymph system. We don't really know, but it's kind of an interesting idea. Did you ever think about lymph as being a possible way to run a penis? I never thought about that till I saw this particular video some years back. Well, there's a lot of stuff going on around ducks, and I knew this because I live on a beautiful 7 acres out in Bonner Springs, Kansas, and it's pronounced Bonner, not Boner. So, and I have a big pond, and I had 7 ducks, 3 geese, and 2 swans that lived on my pond for many years until we had a Holocaust one winter. The coyotes finally got them all. It was like a massive, massive feather bed just blew up everywhere all over my property. I still find bones and feathers occasionally from that Holocaust. I never replaced them because I just couldn't. I mean, it's so devastating to me. But what I noticed with the 7 ducks, would there be a female duck out walking in the yard. They're funny to watch. They're really interesting. And she'd be out walking in the yard. She'd see a guy she likes, and she'd kind of wiggle up real sexy to him, you know, and say, come on, boy, come on. And he'd hop on. You saw how fast that went. That was slowed down 10 times, guys. So he's on and off in like 1 second flat. And the other guys notice, oh, he's getting some action. Let's get in on it. Well, she didn't start wiggling for them. She started running from them. And two or three of the ducks would jump on her and literally rape her. And she is being raped because she doesn't like it. She's struggling. If she can get to the water, she'll dive down to the water. Female ducks have even drowned as a result of trying to get away from male ducks. So ducks rape a lot. So that's kind of the background for understanding this. For years, duck scientists, duck biologists, tried to figure out why do ducks have penises like this? I mean, that penis is not straight, it's corkscrewed, isn't it? And it's really long. Why do they have such a long corkscrewed penis? And scientists and biologists argued about this for years. Until a scientist in Edinburgh, Scotland, University of Edinburgh, named Dr. Patricia Brennan, a female, decided to do a radical thing. She said, let's look inside the female and see what's going on there. Nobody thought about looking inside the female. So she opens up a female, several female ducks, and here's what she finds. She finds a vagina that's corkscrewed in the opposite direction of the penis. Isn't that interesting? A vagina that's corkscrewed in the opposite direction of the penis. She also found all sorts of pockets throughout the vagina that were designed, looked like they were designed to stop sperm from going anywhere. Dead ends. So she also did some experiments and found that the duck can ejaculate into a tube similar to this or a tube similar to this. But if you corkscrew it the wrong direction or put a kink in it, he has a much harder time getting very deeply. He still will ejaculate, but it doesn't go anywhere. So this is all fascinating. And she knew that there was ducks rape a lot. So what next question she asked was, what's going on here? Are those rapists really getting to the eggs? Are they really fertilizing the eggs? And as she did DNA, with the advent of DNA research and our ability to look in, and she found that 97% of all the eggs she laid were by the guy she likes. Only 3% of the eggs were fertilized by the rapists. So Todd Aiken in Missouri, ducks can shut that whole thing down. As we'll see later, humans can't, but Todd may have been miseducated. He was thinking about ducks when he said that, and not humans. So we see that it's a war. It's a war between the female and the males, and we're also going to see later it's a war between the males on who's going to get the egg. In this sense, the female, when she mates with the guy she likes, can relax this whole system here, which allows him to penetrate farther and ejaculate deeper. And it doesn't trap semen. When the rapists come along, she tightens it back up, and they're not going to get very far in there, and when they do ejaculate, it's going to get caught in one of these side pockets there. So it's a remarkably efficient system for letting the duck shut the whole thing down, to use Todd Aiken's. And she does it quite successfully. 97% is a pretty successful rate. So what we have here, and what we can call this, is antagonistic coevolution. That's the biological term, antagonistic coevolution. Organisms are all the time competing with each other. And it's not just, quote, survival of the fittest. There's all sorts of things going on inside the sex organs. Every species has this going on. There's all sorts of shapes and sizes of penises. So every species has their own mating strategy, and we have our mating strategy. Look at mammals, for example. This is a sample of mammalian penises. And they're all different. And they're not that far unrelated to each other. So this tells us, all you have to do is look at the penis oftentimes, and you can guess at what the strategy of that particular species is. The penis gives away hints about the strategic approach of that particular species to reproduction. and particularly how they're implanting semen into the female. Now, of course, it's always helpful to look at the female side, as Dr. Brennan demonstrated. Here's a fellow, he's called the spiny anteater, and this is his penis. Have you ever seen anything like that, a four-headed penis? If this guy thinks with his head, he's in big trouble, isn't he? He ejaculates out of this one today and that one tomorrow, or this hour and that hour. He alternates. These do not ejaculate. There's nothing comes out of it. When he makes love to this particular lady, he does it very carefully, as you can probably imagine. But we could assume that this penis has evolved as a very specific response to the strategic approach of the females or of other males within that particular species. This is an Australian, I believe, marsupial. So what we know is that sex is actively evolving, and it's evolving among us great apes. And by the way, you're one of the great apes, whether you like it or not. We have all sorts of modifications to our sex organs that we can demonstrate. And I want to demonstrate that a bit to you. We have four different great apes, the gorillas, we have the chimps, we have the bonobos. And bonobos look a lot like chimps, but they're about 10% smaller, and they have a very different sexuality. And we have humans, of course. So. This is a recently married couple out of Washington State. All right, so size has some real importance among our fellow primates, our great apes. And some of you are setting that, but well, some of you back there may be thinking, oh, well, you didn't include the orangutan, and you're right, I didn't. Because generally speaking, they're not closely enough related to us to be considered one of the great apes. They're kind of in between. So it wasn't an oversight, it was intentional on my part. But size does matter to different primates, and let's look at how size matters. Size matters to gorillas, because that is a gorilla's penis. That is the size of a gorilla penis. Isn't that interesting? Because size matters not in penis size, but in body size. And we'll come back and look at that. This is the size of a chimpanzee or a bonobo ape's penis, and this is the size of a human's penis. So we'll get into pornography later. I just wanted to keep it simple here for now. We'll look at the real things. So that gives you a real clue as to just how big and how small other penises can be among species that are very closely related to us. So every primate has its own sexual style and strategy. And beginning with the gorillas, gorillas are polygamous. Now, that's a human term, of course. It just means that there's one man, one male for a number of females. I don't think any gorilla would use that term. It's not quite the same because the females can come and go. They're not trapped. They just kind of commit for 4 years, and then they might move on to the next guy if they like. But they're polygamous, and there's a high degree of sexual dimorphism. Now, dimorphism in this sense simply means the difference in size between the male and the female. Among mammals, the more difference there is in size, the bigger the male is from the female, the more females the male tries to dominate and control and mate with. So that, you know, the elephant seal is gigantic. He's like four times bigger than a female. And he might try to dominate and control and mate with half a dozen other females, or even more in some cases. So among mammals, when you have a very big male, they tend to control or mate with a wide range of females. And of course, some males don't get any, and that's what happens among the gorillas. So the females are very mobile, though. They can come and go if they like. They usually come, I'm sorry. When a female comes of age, she has to leave her troop. Females cannot stay with the troop. So they leave the troop, and they have to go around and find somebody that'll let them into their troop. And she has to entice the silverback male to let her come in. And she may stay for 4 or 5 years, but then they might move on to another silverback. They're not chained to that particular male. I mean, how do you chain a female to a male in the jungle? It'd be kind of hard. Sex only lasts for about a minute, and they only have sex about once a month. Doesn't sound like my kind of thing. The penis is only 1.25 inches long, and they have very small testes. Their testes are only half the size of humans. They don't produce much semen either. They don't need to. They're only getting it once a month. And they only mate when they are in estrus. I mean, when the female is actually fertile. Now, the interesting thing about this is the gorilla has what I would call a very traditional mating style. This is the style that most mammalian species on the planet follow. But it's different. It's traditional in the sense of how you look at other animals, but different from what the other three great apes have. The next, and we'll come back and look on that. Now, sex takes on other functions. We saw the gorilla has a very traditional style, very much like other species, but sometimes sex takes on different functions, as we'll see in the chimpanzees, bonobos, and we humans. So how many of you, let's ask the question, why do we even have sex? Has anybody read that book, Parasite Rex? Parasite Rex, okay. If you haven't read it, don't read it. You will have nightmares for weeks afterwards. You have no idea how many parasites are just waiting to get in you and do all sorts of weird things to you, including your brain. And we already have those parasites, many of them in us, so you're not going to escape. You'll just get educated as to which ones are doing what to you. But it's a very good book by Carl Zimmer, I believe it was, and he just got an award. He's written several books since that one, but that's a very interesting book. So we probably have sex. The reason we have sex is to keep ahead of parasites, keep ahead of diseases. Every time you have sex, you mix up the genes, and that makes it harder for parasites and other kinds of pathogens to get in us and do their dastardly work. But even with that's a good reason why we have sex, but it doesn't explain why we humans and bonobos and chimps have a particular kind of sex that is so different from our friends the gorillas. So sex may be repurposed, and that's what's happening here. All the nature, we repurpose a lot of things. Species repurpose a lot of things and use them for things that weren't originally evolved for. How many of you have typed on a computer in the last few days? Okay, did God make your hands to type on a computer? Well, first of all, he didn't make your hands, but if he did, to type on a computer. No, you've repurposed those hands. Those hands were made for grasping limbs and climbing primarily, because our hands look a heck of a lot like the guys that do that, other primates and monkeys. So those hands were tree grasping things. We then repurposed them to use with tools. Of course, apes and stuff use tools as well, but we've taken that to a new height. So you could also repurpose, you can repurpose sex, not just for reproduction, but to establish dominance hierarchies. You know, who gets to have sex, who doesn't get to have sex, and how does that relate to the social structure? Create bonding. It makes organisms stick together. And I don't mean one-on-one. It could be many animals sticking together, as we'll see in the bonobos. It can help reduce conflict. And how many of you have ever had a fight with your spouse or your boyfriend, girlfriend, and after that you made love, and it sure felt good. Get over that. Anybody done that before? And another bunch of liars in here. Dang. All right. So, and to relieve stress. I think sex is a great stress reliever, and there's lots of evidence that it creates a lot of endorphins that help us get over stressful situations. Now, let's look at the chimps first. Chimps' motto is, may the best sperm win. Chimps are really good at producing sperm. They have enormous testicles that produce copious amounts of sperm, and they're twice the size of humans. They have a fairly large penis not larger than ours, but pretty large for a species their size, and they mate frequently. But they mate frequently only with a hierarchical system. The top two, three, four males get to mate with any of the other females, and the low guys in the totem pole may not get anything. Or if they do, they have to kind of sneak off in the forest. And there is rape among chimps. But that's the main thing about sex is in chimp world is it's frequent, but it's only among the hierarchy. It's within the hierarchy. The other thing is the sex is only done during estrus. Females, when they're fertile, will present themselves with a big red billboard on their butt that says, I'm ready, and then they'll go around and present themselves to high-class, high-status males. They do not present themselves to low status males. So here we see sex as being used to create and support a social structure within that community. So they only mate during estrus, and the male status alliances allow for control of the group. Sometimes those alliances will break up. Sex only lasts for 30 minutes. It's getting worse here, isn't it? 30 minutes. Gals, if you don't like the way it's going for you now, 30 seconds. I'm sorry, 30 seconds. Thank you for correction. We'd have lost a lot of them there, wouldn't we? 30 seconds, yeah. So it's interesting because they're not, the main focus of the chimp is to pump as much semen into the female as possible and flush the other guy out. Whoever leaves the most semen in there, the last, and flush the other guy out is probably going to fertilize the egg. So that's a bit, but let's keep in mind, they have repurposed sex. Yes, they only have sex when the female is fertile, but sex is a hierarchical component, an important hierarchical component within their particular society. So let's look at the bonobos, because they're actually very much the opposite. Bonobos, girls are the rulers, and there's usually a hierarchy of two or three females that kind of keep everybody else under control. And if a male should get out of line, even though the females are slightly smaller than the males, the two or three top females will gang up on a male and beat the crap out of him and say, behave yourself from now on. And then they'll settle back down. But sex is almost everywhere among the bonobos. There's male-female sex, there's male-male sex, there's female-female sex. There's sex everywhere among the bonobos. They have, and they menstruate like we do, but they have hidden estrus. You cannot look at a bonobo and tell if they're fertile or not. Just like I can't look at any woman in this room and tell if she's fertile or not right now. It's rare, it's very rare in nature that animals have hidden estrus. But we have hidden estrus, the bonobos have a hidden estrus, there are some other species. I think I read there's 5 species that we've confirmed have hidden estrus. Why is that? I will not tell you today. You'll have to go look it up. Go look up, how many of you read P.Z. Myers? Okay, if you read P.Z. Myers, just Google P.Z. Myers hidden estrus, and he's got a great article on the latest research. I think we finally figured out why you women don't let us know when you're fertile or not. So we have a pretty large penis for our size of species, and they have a pretty large penis, and they have huge testes, twice as big as ours, about the same size as the chimps. And they can mate anytime with anyone. Sex is everywhere. Here's what goes on with the bonobos. They wake up one morning and say, I want some morning sex, and they have morning sex. They see a predator go by, and everybody's getting all scared and hiding, and when the danger is gone, they have a big orgy, and they have sex all over the place. The ones walking down the forest, through the forest, and they see a beautiful fruit tree with fresh fruit on it, and they holler and scream and jump up and down. Everybody comes, what's the big deal? He says there's great fruit there, and they have an orgy before they eat the fruit. You have to have sex before you can eat. I kind of like this, right? You know, sex before supper, sex before breakfast, sex before lunch. You're done. There are thousands of sex acts among the bonobo apes for every live birth. In other words, bonobos have repurposed sex. What's the purpose? To keep the troop together, to keep peace among the troop. They use it for all sorts of things. They use it for conflict management. If two bonobos get in a fight, when they're finished fighting, they have sex. There's tons and tons of sex between males. If two males get in a fight, they'll have sex when they're finished. I came across this comic. I think it's kind of funny. They're at a zoo, and he's reading, and he says here that in bonobo societies, females are in charge, and sex rather than violence is used to keep order. And she says, thank God we've evolved. Here's some pictures of bonobos. Here's two females, French kissing, in missionary position. Isn't that interesting? The female clitoris on a bonobo is about as big as my little finger. And they love to play with them. They love other people to play with them. They love to rub them against each other. It's just, you know, they have a lot of fun in the bonobo community doing that. This is a bonobo penis Look at that real carefully, guys. Does that look like yours? No, not a little bit closer than the ducks, probably, but not still not yours. Imagine this. There's a male, female having sex. They like the missionary style a lot, missionary position a lot. Imagine this. You are a homeschool creationist family, and you've decided to take a trip to the zoo to talk about how God created everything. And you come across, in the San Diego Zoo, you come across bonobos having sex, missionary style, French kissing each other. I think that might mess the lesson plan up for the day, don't you? It's pretty obvious that those folks have repurposed sex for bonding purposes, for stress management purposes, for conflict management purposes. It has little or nothing to do with actual reproduction. Sex is not a reproductive, nearly as important as those other things. So we've seen there's rapid change is going on in the genitals of all these organisms we've looked at, from the flowers to the ducks to the the general mammals to the primates. But recently in Science News on September 8th, an article said that when scientists compared 1,880 proteins encoded by genes from humans and rodents, a number of proteins involved in reproduction ranked among those with the greatest number of changes. Three are directly involved in sperm-egg interaction. In other words, there's evidence in rodents and in humans that some of the fastest changing genes in our species or in rodent species are those related to how we reproduce, just like we saw among flowers. Rapid stuff going on here, which says that our genitals and things could have evolved very rapidly. What we look like now might not have been what we looked like 500,000 years ago or 1,000,000 years ago. It's changed very rapid. So let's look at the human sexual strategy and ask some questions. I mentioned earlier antagonistic coevolution, and that's the antagonism between the males and the females, like the duck example I showed earlier. And we can also see it between males, in the way males compete with each other, and we can see it in the way the sperm competes with each other. I'll come back and talk about each of those in some detail. But we can ask, why is the human penis so large? Why is the human penis shaped so different from other primates? Why does human sex last so long? I mean, average human's sexual intercourse lasts 4 to 10 minutes. That's a heck of a lot longer than any of the other primates that we saw. Thank goodness. Why do humans have testes that are larger than gorillas but smaller than chimps? Why does human sperm have different kinds of sperm in it? There's actually a variety of sperm in your semen. Why do women hide their menstrual cycle? Why is the female reproductive tract so hostile to sperm? And why do women have breasts? We got all these questions related to who we are and why we function the way our bodies do. So everything we see in our bodies is evidence of human evolution in some way, shape, or form. Close your eyes, guys, if you don't like this. But this is a penis, if you've seen one before. They are real interesting instruments. Does that look like the bonobo's penis? No, if you just put your finger out like that, that's the shape of a bonobo or a chimp's penis. And so biologists have asked for years, why is the human penis shaped like that with the coronal edge around it? Until a guy named Robin Baker out of the University of Manchester in England decided he would try a little experiment. He went down to the porn shop, disguised obviously, so the Christians wouldn't recognize him, and he got one of those vaginas. You know, you can get fake vaginas these days. And he got a dildo that was shaped a lot like this over here, and he injected liquid into the vagina that had the viscosity of semen. Now, semen actually has a number of different viscosities. It's not all the same. So he tried different viscosities to test. And then he put the dildo in the vagina and pumped it just to see what's going on. And what, lo and behold, happened, 80% of all the liquid that was in there was pumped out. He could get rid of 80% of the liquid that went into the vagina just by pumping. In other words, he established that this is a vacuum pump. You remember I said the bonobos and chimps flush the other guy out? We pump the other guy out. That's why sex takes so long. It takes a lot of work to pump other guys out of the vagina. Think about that. So that tells us why human sex lasts so long and why the penis is shaped so different from the other primates that we're very, very closely related to. Now, guys, what happens? The minute you ejaculate, what happens then? No, you don't go to sleep. It's before you go to sleep. What happens just before you go to sleep? You have a cigarette? Well, no. Even before you have the cigarette, before you can even get the cigarette lit, what happens? You go flaccid. Yeah, it just goes, you know, like that. And, well, why would we do that? Because we don't want to pump our own semen out. We want to pump the other guy's semen out. That's what the pump, vacuum pump's all about. So, kind of interesting stuff here until you start looking at sperm. And for years, people have wondered, why are there so many, quote, deformed sperm in our semen? And nobody could figure this out until Robin Baker wrote a book and did a lot of research on this called The Sperm Wars. It's a very interesting book. I'm not going to claim that everything he says in there is right. I think probably new research has made some modifications on it. But what he found, there's really three kinds of sperm in semen. And only about 15% of the sperm are actually designed to get an egg, designed to actually fertilize an egg. That's called the getter sperm, go get them sperm. And then there's two other kinds of sperm, the warrior sperm and the blocker sperm. The warrior sperm go out and kill other sperm. They've got proteins on them that can identify, are you friendly or are you an enemy? And I'm going to kill you if you're an enemy. So there's a war going on between sperm inside the vagina. Long after the guy's gone, he's still fighting other guys inside of you ladies. Isn't that interesting? I just think it's fascinating. And then the third kind of sperm is blocker sperm. And we have the same gene for blocker sperm that the bonobos and the chimps have. But our blocker sperm gene does not work as well as theirs does. If you're a chimp and you ejaculate in the female, your sperm will make a thick coagulated block plug that's designed to get around the cervix and stop sperm from getting in. So, you know, once I've got in there, I want to stop the other guy from getting up into close to the egg. So it coagulates, makes a big, thick sperm block, and then the other guy can't get through. Now, I don't know, guys. I know most of you said you didn't masturbate. But if just in case you had a wet dream one night, you may have noticed that if you felt the semen, it was very, very slick to begin with, and then very quickly became very sticky. Well, that's probably the blocker sperm working there. And the blocker sperm works really well among chimps and bonobos. Like I said, not quite as well among us, but it's still there. Here's the cool thing is we have unblocker chemistry too. There's sperm that have a protein that will dissolve the block. Isn't that, it's like a war, isn't it? An arms race, an evolutionary arms race, antagonistic coevolution. That's what it's all about. Now, this is not unique to primates. We see these very same characteristics in sperm and sexual activity among lots and lots of other species. So it's pretty interesting that we're so different and yet we're so similar in many ways. But what it all says, and this is the bottom line, we are a multimate species. How many of you have ever been told we're a monogamous species? Yeah, right. Who told you that? I'm guessing it was somebody in a religious organization told you that, or somebody influenced by a religious organization. So we can imagine, we can say that there's a ton of evidence just in our biology we're nowhere near a monogamous species. Now, I'll tell you what a monogamous species looks like. The anglerfish. The anglerfish, the female is very large, the male is very tiny, and the male embeds himself in the skin of the female fish and stays there for life. That's monogamy, all right? I could say that probably you may not know a single monogamous person. You may not know a single monogamous person in all the people you know or acquainted with. Because monogamy, according to Jesus, was one mate for life. Not a boyfriend or a girlfriend before you got married, but one sexual partner for life. That's monogamy. If anybody says anything different, they're not talking about monogamy, and I don't buy into this serial monogamy bullshit. It's not, there's no such thing, serial monogamy. You're either monogamous or you're not. It's a pretty cut and dried, right and wrong, the light's on or the light's off. And so what I'd like to do is broaden our understanding of who we are as human beings by not using the stupid language that religion has put on us. Now, you may like to have an exclusive relationship with somebody for a number of years, and it may be 50 years, I don't care, but that doesn't mean you're a monogamous, and doesn't mean our species is, just because that's your particular preference. So we are a multi-mate species. And we have lots of sex, evidently, or we wouldn't have a pump to pump other guys out. Ladies, you have been playing around, and you haven't been telling us about it for a lot of time. And there was a great social psychology experiment happened in Toronto, Canada, a few years back. Sex researchers have noticed for many years that women report anywhere from 25 to 30% seventy to 75% fewer sex partners than men do. If men say they have 10 sex partners in their lifetime so far, at maybe 30 years of age, a woman at 30 years of age will say, "Well, I've had three." So you do the math here. Is that possible? I'm not sure how that works. So what they did was they set up an experiment and they did a face-to-face interview with a lot of different questions, one of which was, how many sex partners have you had? So you'd have a researcher talking to a male, and then the next one come in, and researcher talking to a female, and that would be what they'd say. The women would say, well, I've had three sex partners, the guy'd say, I had 10. Then they changed the situation, and they asked the same questions, but they put it on paper in a different room. So now the women and the men would go into a room, they'd answer it privately, and they'd have to walk out of the room and hand it to a researcher. So they would know, somebody would know who answered that question that way. What happened? Women's sex partners doubled. They went up to 5 or 6 sex partners if they weren't looking a guy or a gal in the eye saying, yeah. So then they changed the situation, the condition one more time, and they put men and women on a lie detector machine. Now, so far, the men have always said 10 and 10. The men haven't changed the number of partners they had. I'm just drawing these figures out of the air for illustration. So they put them on a lie detector machine. Now, it really wasn't a lie detector machine. It was a fake one. But the women didn't know this. The men didn't know it. And they asked them, same questions, how many sex partners have you had? And the men said 10. And the women said 10. Aha! What's going on here? You're lying. You're lying about how many sex partners you've had in your life. Why would a man not lie, but a woman would lie? It's cultural shame, isn't it? We shame women for being open and unashamed about their sexuality. Where did we get such a crazy idea? Well, that's why I wrote the Sex and God. I wanted to explore why we shame women, and quite frankly, why we shame men too, because men experience some level of shame. Imagine a world without religion. Appropriate, age-appropriate sex education, science-based sex education for children, not that abstinence-only crap. Women's sexuality and sex drive is seen as normal. Sexual orientation is not even noticed. Women feel safe, and rape is extremely rare. There's no shaming for abortion. There's no stigma for being single. And responsible sexual behavior is the norm. Can you imagine that? I can't yet, but I'd like to move us towards that. Male sexuality is openly celebrated, and pornography is seen as normal. No priests or ministers are out molesting children. So what we know among us humans is sex is made for recreation and bonding. We know that when you have sex, it releases oxytocin in the brain, the bonding chemical, and you feel closer to the person you're having sex with. And hopefully it's reciprocated in some way, especially if you have orgasm. So for humans, we have repurposed sex just like the bonobos have repurposed sex. Sex is for having a good time and keeping close to someone else. It's kind of like our hands have been repurposed to type on typewriters. We have 1,000 and probably more like 10,000 sex acts for for every baby born, for every conception. So if you're having, and I'm including masturbation here for everybody, so just think, how many times do you masturbate in your life versus how many times you have a baby? And that's enormous numbers. And if you never have a child, then you've had a, your entire life has been non-procreative, which is just fine. We got 7 billion people on the planet. We don't need any more, necessarily. Have one if you need it, but only if you need it or want it. All right, so what's this all tell us about our friend the Pope? Well, the Pope doesn't understand human sexuality. I've gone through all this evolutionary stuff because it's really important to understand who and what we are. I don't want to just jump into religion. We know that pretty well, but there's probably been some things you didn't know earlier, and it illustrates we are evolving sexual creatures. And the Pope doesn't seem to know this because he thinks, this is my dog Sugar here. She has a rule. I always have to have her in the presentation if there's a dog. So the Pope tells us we should have sex like a dog, like my dog Sugar. Because dogs only have sex when the female is in estrus. Dogs don't just go out and screw somebody for the fun of it. They wait, they get interested, males get interested in a female when they smell. Oh, by the way, if you ever come across dog pornography, you know what that would be? It would be smells. Dogs wouldn't look at porn, they'd smell porn. So even within the species, we see, between our two species, we see a huge difference in what eroticizes us, makes us interested in the opposite sex. But the Pope says, have sex like a dog. Only have sex when you're ready to procreate, or only for procreation. And that is about the stupidest thing you can ask a human to do. It's also pretty stupid to say you have to be celibate for the rest of your life if you're a priest. And what's going to happen? I write about this rather extensively in Sex and God. What is going to happen to a person who cannot express their natural biological urges? They're probably going to express them in some other way, inappropriately. A friend of mine who's an ex-priest, where's Stephen in here, by the way? Ex-priest. Another, not Stephen. I'm not talking about Stephen. A friend of mine who's an ex-priest said, well, if you make sexual perversion a requirement for the job, would it be any surprise that sexual perverts apply for the job? Those are his words, okay. Related to Catholic priests. But in some ways, you see this in all religion, all religious leaders. They restrict sexuality, and they may not restrict to celibacy, but you know, you got poor Ted Haggard, who's gay as the day is long, and he can't express it except with a gay prostitute in Denver while doing methamphetamines. I do have some good news for you. They prayed over him for 4 or 5 weeks, fundamentalist ministers, and they prayed the gay away for him. I'm not sure if they got the methamphetamine addiction, but they did pray the gay away. At the time all this happened, it was about 4 or 5 years ago, I told all my friends, I got lots of friends in Colorado City, Colorado Springs, I told them, he will be back. He came down here, guys. He came down to Phoenix to sell insurance. It didn't work out so well for him, so guess what? He went back to Colorado Springs. I told all my friends before all this happened, watch, he will be back. And lo and behold, about 2 years ago, he went back to Colorado Springs, and he's got a new mega church. And he outgrew the first building, and they're getting another one right now. Isn't that amazing? How do they come back so quickly? And that's what happens. You see this all over the place among religious leaders. They come back very quickly. I'm not going to go into why that happens. I do write about that extensively in The God Virus. Why do religious leaders get off with murder, almost literally sometimes? Okay, now back to our Pope. Our friend the Pope says you should not even masturbate. How many of you are raised Catholic in here? Okay, how many are raised Mormon in here? Okay, we got a few Mormons here. Well, you know, Mormons get that little pamphlet when they're 12 years old that says, don't tamper with the factory. And Catholics have a similar kind of thing. Oh, they don't hand it out, I don't think. They just tell you to be guilty of touching yourself from birth. And that's really a problem, because masturbation is actually an essential ingredient of staying sexually healthy. You can't have sex with somebody every day. And the Pope says you shouldn't have sex unless you're procreating. But that's a problem, because masturbation keeps the pipes clean. And it keeps the inventory fresh. Sperm only lasts about 5 days inside of the human male, and only about 5 days inside of the female. So that's part of the reason why you got to pump the other guy out, because he could have been there 4 days before. You still have a chance to get him out. But for yourself, you want to have fresh sperm. If you don't masturbate, then your sperm are always less than healthy, because you're keeping some of the dead ones around, some of the ones that aren't quite up to speed yet. You know, a five day old sperm is like an 85 year old human. They're probably not going to perform quite as well. So we need to keep those sperm fresh. Keep going, guys. Keep it going. And the fact is, if you keep it going, you're probably going to keep going. It's got a positive feedback loop there. Ladies, masturbation is important for you too. I met a Catholic gal one time, a lover of mine. She had never masturbated. She claimed she'd never been masturbated. And I believed her, because she was so embarrassed to even talk about it. But gave her a few lessons. She started practicing. And what we found was what's normal. I gave her one of those little peanuts. I don't know, you know, the vibrator. Ooh, they are great. They work very well. I even break some to sell at these talks, but I forgot them. I walked out and forgot them. But you can get them online, just the peanut. It's yeah, you'll wear the batteries out on them if you're not careful, though. They're not very big. So with women, the more you, if you masturbate, what you do is you keep yourself sexually responsive. Women who don't masturbate are not as sexually responsive to their mates as women who do. Now, of course, you're having lots of sex, you may not need that, but if you're not having a lot of sex, you got to keep the machinery going. You got to keep it lubricated, you got to keep it responding. And it also cleans things out and helps you stay sexually healthy. Those are all pretty important things on the female side as well. So we are so embarrassed to talk about these things. And as an atheist, I am not embarrassed, and I don't want you to be embarrassed. I want you to start thinking about how has religion distorted your sexuality. And that's exactly why I subtitled Sex and God, How Religion Distorts Sexuality, because it takes what's normal, natural, and something we should not be afraid of, should not be ashamed of, and makes us feel ashamed. We use sex for stress relief. When I masturbate, I feel lots of sexual relief. When I have sex, I feel sexual relief from stress. And I'm sure you do too. Sounds just like the bonobos, doesn't it? We're very closely related to them, and they found that stress is relieved through a lot of sex. And so when we're told by the religious organizations that we should not have sex, you know, or limited, or there's certain ways that you can only have sex, you know, sex doggy style is permitted among the Seventh-day Adventists or whatever, then you got to question what's going on there. There's a reason why religionists tend to force us to feel guilty about things, and I call this the guilt cycle. And the guilt cycle is a fairly simple concept. You get taught guilt when you're a kid, and here's the way you're taught. Your mom says don't get a cookie before supper, so you sneak in and you grab a cookie out of the cookie jar one day, and she catches you. She slaps your hand. You say, okay, I won't do that anymore. The next day you're thinking, man, that cookie really tasted good. You sneak around, you see mom's not looking, you get a cookie out of the cookie jar and you eat it. Well, there's no mom around, so it tasted really good, but here's the problem. You violated mom's rule. So that creates cognitive dissonance. Here's what mom told me to do, here's what I did. The degree to which those are separated creates dissonance, and it's expressed itself as guilt. It's a simple concept, simply easy to understand. Now what happens is religion comes along and says, ah, we can teach you what to be guilty of. I watched my grandmother, who was very, very religious, push my youngest brother's penis, a hand away from his penis, when he was an infant. Now, why would you push an infant's hand away? They play with it all the time. They play with it even when they're in the womb, except for her guilt cycle. She was a guilty woman. She was extremely good at propagating the God virus into my family. And I mean, I loved her, but she had major flaws, and that was religion. So we've got that religious guilt cycle coming in. Religion says, okay, we're going to teach you what to be guilty of. And it's just coincidental that what we're going to teach you to be guilty of is the thing you're going to do anyway. You are going to masturbate. You are going to have premarital sex. So then you have sex, or you masturbate, and then you feel guilty, and you've got to go get forgiveness. Well, if you're a Catholic, where do you get forgiveness? At confession. If you're a Baptist, where do you get forgiveness? You got to go to Bible study. You got to pray. You got to read the Bible. It's a lot harder to get forgiveness among those Baptists. So you got to work at it if you're a Baptist or a Nazarene or a Seventh-day Adventist or even a Mormon, probably. So there's the beauty of the guilt cycle is it always brings you back to the place you learned the disease. Religion gives you the disease. Religion gives you the disease and then gives you a fake cure for the disease. The only place you can get relief from the stress caused by this guilt is at the church you learned the guilt from. All right, so we've talked a lot about masturbation, one of my favorite topics. Let's move on, though, to pornography, which is actually closely related to masturbation. What is the number one porn search state in the nation? Utah. Number two? Number two? Mississippi. Mississippi is number two, all right? Isn't that funny? So Utah and Mississippi. Now, we recently had an election, and I think this is interesting coincidence. It's not a perfect overlay of the recent election, but it will show you something. This is where the highest number of gay porn searches are in the United States. This is where the highest number of gay porn search sites in the United States. Isn't that interesting? There's only a few. I mean, Obama took there, so that didn't work, and took that. That didn't work. But all these homophobic Southerners, Baptists, they're all searching for homosexual sex. Isn't that interesting? Fascinating. Have you heard of a book called A Billion Wicked Thoughts? Anybody heard of that book? If you haven't, it's the third best book written on sex. It's an excellent book, and it's a couple researchers who've done tremendous research on the internet and how people are using the internet sexually. And they're the ones, they put out a lot of this information. And they found a lot of interesting stuff correlating directly between religionists and sexual activity on the internet. Now, most of us have been exposed to Christian sex. And there's Christian sex, there's Catholic sex, there's Mormon sex, Mormon sexuality, if you will. There's Buddhist sexuality, there's Hindu sexuality, there's Muslim sexuality. And not one of those is very closely related, if at all, to human sexuality. Human sexuality is different than Christian sexuality. But we have allowed the Christians to define who we are. I am not a Christian. I don't need to act like a Christian. So that's what I want to challenge you about today. Why do we act within our sexual being as a Christian? And it means we need to challenge some ideas. The last five chapters of Sex and God, I actually wrote hoping that couples will read the book and talk about those last five chapters. It will force you to ask questions about how you're raising your children, how you're relating to your spouse or your sex partners or partners. So, I want to help you and those you love get over the residual effects of religious sex. I want you to begin to build a framework for secular sexuality as opposed to Catholic sexuality or Mormon sexuality. I want us to celebrate positive, natural secular sexuality, not just within our community, but everywhere. I love the LGBT community. They made a decision 20 years ago or so to say, we're not going to take it anymore. We are not ashamed of who we are. And we're going to come out, we're going to wear things that show that we are gay, and we're not going to let anybody intimidate us. And look what the results have been. The same thing could be true for us. I think sex is the weak spot of religion. Sex, almost all religions lie about their sexuality. And that is a huge problem for them because it creates enormous hypocrisy. And they're very, very aware of it. If I go up to a Christian and I want to debate whether God exists or not, I'll waste about another hour. If I look and I say, are you teaching your children not to masturbate? And they say, yes. And I say, well, you know, I masturbate. Don't you? What are they going to do? They're going to either lie and say, oh, no, I never do that, which we know they're lying. Or they might say, well, yeah, but I can't tell my children. So in other words, you're lying to your children. See, I'm not going to debate. I don't want to debate personally with people I'm involved with and want to kind of give them a little nudge once in a while. I don't want to debate with them. I want to kind of challenge them. And I want to show them where they themselves are not living up to their own standards. 95% of all Americans have premarital sex. And most of those people have premarital sex with somebody they do not get married to. If I ask how many of you had premarital sex in a Baptist church, almost no one would raise their hand. And yet, research goes back to the 1950s. 95% of Americans have premarital sex. So they're lying. So again, I could say to my religious friend, did you have premarital sex? And they'll say, no, I never had premarital sex. And I could say, well, I had premarital sex, and 95% of all people on the planet have premarital sex. What's wrong with you? You know, just simple things like that. Now, you have to be tactful, of course, but you could have debated whether God exists or not for an hour or two and probably made less headway than just asking those two little questions, because it brings out the enormous cognitive dissonance they're facing every day they wake up and have the urge to masturbate, or have the urge to spank their wife while they're having sex, or the wife has an urge to tie her husband up and tease her. So there's all sorts of things that people won't talk about, but they want to do, and they have to lie about it to each other. So what they do is they express it somewhere else. They go have an affair. They hire a prostitute. They go do something dangerous that they shouldn't be doing. And you see a lot of dangerous behavior among religionists doing things. I mean, that's why we see wherever abstinence only is being taught, you see the highest number of teen pregnancies and sexually transmitted infections. You don't see that where science-based sex education is being taught. Because we teach kids how to use a condom. We teach kids how to negotiate relationships so that both parties are safe. So I want to encourage us to be open and out about our sexuality. Now, you've heard of Jeff Foxworthy and the redneck stuff. I want to challenge you a little bit about your own, not redneck, but I think if you're an atheist, and I'm guessing a lot of you in here are atheists, if you're an atheist, you're probably a Christian atheist. And I'll bet you never heard that term before, a Christian atheist. Well, let's see what that means. You might be a Christian atheist if you feel guilty about masturbating. You might be a Christian atheist if you feel shame about admitting you enjoy porn. You might be a Christian atheist if you have difficulty talking to your children about sex or sexuality. You might be a Christian atheist if you have difficulty talking to your spouse or partner about sexual fantasies you'd like to try. You might be a Christian atheist if you feel disgust around normal sexual activities. And you might be a Christian atheist if you shame other people, especially women, for being sexual. And this is a pet peeve of mine, and I see it in our own community far too much. I see slut shaming. I see our community shaming women for acting normal, for acting and expressing themselves sexually. And that is absolutely wrong and inappropriate in our system. There's no need to use sexual innuendo to anybody in our community, especially not women. I don't think it's any better for men, but we don't see it as often in men. So lesson number one from Darrel today is check your sexual prejudice at the door when you're emailing somebody or when you're online chat or when you're criticizing a blogger about something. There's no need to use any kind of sexual innuendo. It doesn't enhance your argument. And how many of you have seen that online? People arguing over some religious or atheist thing, and suddenly it comes out, well, you're ugly, that's why you believe that way, or something like that. I mean, it's just absolutely horrendous and inappropriate. And I see it in our community. I want to start correcting that. It's just wrong. So I am not a Christian, and I don't need to act like one. If you're not a Christian, let's not act like one. Let's start challenging some of those very deep, basic assumptions that people get from the time they're before they're even conscious. When my grandmother pushed my youngest brother's penis away, that she was beginning to teach him religiously based sexual shame. And there's no place for that in us. And yet you were programmed in that way before you even knew it. And maybe your parents didn't, but hey, it wasn't my mom that did that. It was my grandmother that did that. So that tells you lots of people are trying to program you and your sexuality long before you know it, and it's not necessarily within your own family. How many of you guys, I wasn't in the girls' locker room, if you were in a guy's locker room, how many of you heard something like, you know, if you shake it more than twice, you're playing with it? You hadn't heard that, ladies? Okay, what that really means, I heard it when I was 13, 14 years old, you know, in junior high, middle school, you go to the locker, you're all naked, and somebody says, oh, you shook it more than three times, you're a homosexual, or you, that's masturbation. Where did they get the idea that masturbating is wrong or shameful? Where did they get the idea that masturbating will make you a homosexual? I mean, those are crazy, crazy ideas that are being taught to our kids, your kids. You can be an atheist, but your kid is still going to middle school where he's going to find out that you shake it more than twice, you're playing with it. It is a religious-induced brainwashing about our shame. And I want to say one more thing about shame, because we all know a lot about female shame. It's throughout our culture. But nobody talks about male shame. And I think male shame is just as important, because I think male shame drives female shame in some ways. Here's the way it works. The males are taught, and we are taught from very early on in this culture, and we may not be as bad at it as some other cultures, but we are taught you control your women. Males are to control their wives. Males are to control their daughters. If a daughter gets pregnant out of wedlock, that reflects shame on the whole family. How many of you were taught that? I was taught that, right. And so even though rationally I may be standing up here thinking, oh yeah, I don't believe that anymore, I still may feel it. It's still there. What you're taught early in life can stick with you long after you've left religion. That's partly why I founded Recovering from Religion. We even have a lot of atheists come to our Recovering from Religion groups to talk about these very things. And oh, by the way, if you go to one of our meetings, you don't go there to lead it. You go there to be a person to participate. We had too many people show up and try to take over the groups. That's not your purpose. But that's just a little side note. So what I want you to do is to examine those shame-based things that we as males are taught. I had a fellow say, my wife went off and hugged three or four guys at a party the other night, and I wasn't there, and I heard about it, and now I'm angry at her. And so I talked to the guy and said, why are you so angry at her? She didn't fuck anybody. She just hugged them. He said, well, now they'll all think she's a slut and that I'm married to a slut. Wow, where'd that come from? She has no right to hug other guys? That's pretty interesting. Now, we would tend to call that jealousy. But in Sex and God, I write about, we need to throw the whole idea of jealousy out. Deconstruct jealousy. What this guy was really saying was, I feel shame that I was taught by my culture. I feel shame about my wife's behavior because I'm not controlling my woman. If we start reframing some of those things, we start realizing our behavior, even though we're an atheist, our behavior is still based on religiously rooted ideas that we may or may not have examined. So, to wrap this up, I am a secular sexual, I'm a sex-positive atheist, and I'm very proud of it. I hope this has been a useful and informative talk for you today, and if you consider it, I'll have books out there, and I'll be happy to sign them when we're finished. Do we have time for some questions or not?
Yeah. Okay.
Thank you.
I just wanted to add one more line that I learned a long time ago. Sex is dirty. Save it for the one you love.
Oh, I've got a quote. Yeah, Butch, I've got a quote by Butch Hancock on that. It's a great line, yeah.
No, I also had a cartoon. These two old men sitting in these big chairs in an old man's club, and one says to the other, now they tell us masturbation is normal.
I want to read this because you reminded me and I didn't have it on here, but I think you'll find it quite funny. Okay, come on. Okay, here's the statement from Butch Hancock that you were quoting. Life in Lubbock, Texas taught me two things. One, that God loves you, and the other, you're going to burn in hell. The other is the sex is the most awful, dirty thing on the face of the earth, and you should save it for someone you love. There you go. Thanks for reminding me. I forgot to put that in there. All right, next question.
Oh. Just one question as a senior citizen. Where were you 50 years ago?
Well, I'm 39, so I wasn't around then, obviously. Now I was learning how to masturbate. As in the first chapter of Sex and God, I talk about my childhood and how I came to be so interested in studying about religion. And my mother took me to the library to check out all these sex books because she was getting tired of me asking all these questions about sex. My mom was fairly open-minded, even for a religious person. So, but she didn't want to answer all these very embarrassing questions. So she took me to the library. Only adults could check out these books, you know, the real sex books. So I kept bringing them home and I read a half a dozen books or more. And I read them all. And they didn't say diddly squat. Just as they get the good stuff, they'd say, talk to your priest or minister about this. I thought, dang, you know. It wasn't until I discovered my dad's porn stash that I was able to really start getting educated about sex. Okay. Next question.
I had a question about what other animals masturbate besides human? Do the bonobos, for example?
Oh, I've got a great story. A Catholic priest, ex-Catholic priest, was telling me some time back. He said he'd gone through all the seminary, and he could go about 30 days without masturbating. And then he'd masturbate and say, oh no, now I'm going to hell. So he'd have to go find a priest and confess. This went through 8 years of seminary. He went through that pre-seminary thing and late seminary, whatever. 8 years of seminary, and towards the end of his seminary, he's at the zoo, and he sees bonobos, or chimps, I'm not sure what they were, masturbating. And he says, okay, the Pope believes in evolution. I believe in evolution. They're masturbating. I like to masturbate. He said that was the first step towards atheism for him. Yeah, he's now one of our atheist leaders in Kansas City area. But bonobos masturbate, chimps masturbate. Look at your dog when he's humping you. He's probably masturbating. He can't reach it himself, so he's got to use somebody else. Hey, it feels good. I don't care if you're a dog or a human. Yeah.
I have a Christian background, and one thing that's always been striking to me is what I feel is unspoken eroticism regarding the crucifixion and also passion plays in churches. Have you ever thought about that or written about that?
I look at the BDSM community, and they just salivate over that stuff.
I think it's really hot.
And I've seen a lot of people. I think people probably, yeah. I think there's a lot of repressed sexuality being expressed in that religious art. That would be my guess. I'm not a Freudian or anything like that. I'm just saying when you don't get to do something, you oftentimes express it in other ways.
Find a way,
right. Yeah. Some of the most craziest BDSM literature things you'll ever see is in the Catholic Church's literature and art. Yeah.
I was lucky enough to be able to meet Albert Ellis and work with him a little bit.
Oh my gosh, I'm glad.
So what was
glad.
Your story?
Yeah.
You said you had a story about him.
What now?
You said you had something you wanted to add at the end.
Oh yeah, I'm sorry, I was gonna tell you later, but yeah, I'll tell you now. See, I was in an auditorium like this, and Albert Ellis was doing some group therapy up front, or was going to, and he asked for volunteers. So I run down there, and I want to be right next to Albert Ellis, and there's like four or five of us in this little group. And I'm just sitting there being a good guy, I'm not talking or anything, and there's this hot gal sitting right next to me, and she's just talking, and she won't shut up. And I'm thinking, okay, he wants to get started, she's not shutting up, I guess because she's probably nervous or something. And what happens is, Albert Ellis looks at me and says, are you going to be quiet so we can get started? Yeah, what do I do, you know? But I know a lot about Albert. So I can say I'm one of the few people who've ever been bawled out in public by Albert Ellis. And I hadn't even done anything. But what he was really doing, I suspect, was he was trying to get me defensive. Because then he'd be able to work on me for a while. I didn't bite. Yes?
You seemed a little light on the Mormon side of things.
Light?
Yeah.
Okay. I thought I was...
On the Mormon type of thing, you know, a lot of people know about the polygamy and the do not masturbate side.
Yeah.
During the period 1970 to 1982, and I don't have the exact date, with the understanding that the Mormon head of the church is a prophet, seer, and revelator.
Right.
They came out with a revelation that was to apply to the whole church. It was right across the pulpits to the whole church that oral sex was banned, period. Ooh. And you could not get a temple recommend if you participated in oral sex.
Wow. That's another reason not to be a Mormon.
But right. the interesting thing is that 10 days later, they retracted it.
Somebody got a blowjob.
Even worse than that, instead of reading it across the pulpits, they only read it to the men of the church.
Oh, that's funny. Okay.
Right after that, throughout the church, there was a tremendous rise in the divorce rate.
Oh, interesting. Okay. How many of you have seen our research on sex and secularism that we did last year? What 14,560 secularists told us about their sex lives? Nobody? Okay, I could have done that talk today. It's a lot of fun, too. I have to come back and do that talk. It's a lot of fun. So, but get online, ipcpress.com, and it's a free download, 48-page report, what 14,560 atheists, 80% were atheists, told us about their sex lives. And we had them answer 69 questions about their sex lives. And yes, that was an accident. We did not intentionally make it 69, just what it turned out to be. But it's a fascinating study, and the reason I say that from the gentleman that just talked, what is the most guilt-based, sexually guilt-based religion in the 27 we tested in the United States? Mainline religions in the United States. What's the most guilt-based? Catholics? You're wrong. Number one, most guilt-based religion in the United States is Mormonism. With Seventh-day Adventist Pentecostals and Jehovah's Witnesses, almost exactly the same. And then we had a big drop. You get online, download that, you'll see all sorts of cool stuff. Catholics are just a little bit behind the Seventh-day Adventists and stuff. But Mormons were number one. They were really guilt-ridden about their sexuality. Okay, question.
You talked about how, although you know we are atheists and we're part of a secular culture, we still inherit this shame.
Right.
And we're looking for ways to do it. I was thinking... you mentioned Dan Savage earlier, and one of the things he's done that I really, really admire is this idea of treating Halloween as if it were Straight Pride Day.
Straight Pride Day.
Instead, because you see most of the slut shaming in Halloween costumes. Oh, you're going to be a sexy nurse or a sexy thing, and as if that's a bad thing. And I think if we reframed it as saying, you know what, sex is great, and look, we get to do it in public.
Excellent.
So for what it's worth, I thought
that's a great idea. I listen to Dan Savage a lot. I hadn't heard that piece, so that's fun. Thanks for letting me know that. So Halloween from now on is a Straight Pride Day. All right. I'll march. Other question? Yeah.
What would you say about the late... Andrea Dworkin, a radical feminist who made a lot of arguments, certainly from a non-religious perspective, against pornography and the like.
This debate about pornography is endless, and it's what is pornography in one person is eroticism to the next person. Every time I see somebody that says they hate pornography, I say, well, would you please define it for me? Because the Supreme Court couldn't even define it. What was it? Justice Potter said, I'll know it when I see it. I'm serious. I've had this talk with Greta Christina, who's a major pornographer. And Greta's tired of it, too. I'm not into censorship. I'm not into telling people what they can and can't do in their own brains or what they want to watch. I am against abuse. I'm against sex trafficking. I'm against having people do things they don't want to do, whether it's online or other places. I think it's a matter of consent and safety and adult consensual behavior. If somebody wants to be tied up and spanked and they want to film it, is that pornography or not? You know, I've got friends that go to BDSM parties, get tied up and whipped, and they like to take pictures of it. Is that erotic or is that pornography? I don't know. They decided to do it. They decided to share it. So I get tired of that. I'm not criticizing you. I just get tired of the debate, because there's no way to define it. There's just no way to stop it. So. Yeah, go ahead.
I'm curious to know what the literature says about the connection between guilt and religion, as to whether that's conscious by design, you know, sort of devious in nature, or if it goes deeper than that, if it's sort of, it was evolved as sort of a subconscious control mechanism.
Well, I actually explore that very question in The God Virus, my previous book, and I think there's a lot of evidence that the guilt, we're programmed to follow certain rules in our culturally. Some people follow them better than others, as we know. you know, some people don't like to follow the rules. But if we can program people to feel guilty about something, it actually makes them follow the rules, well, generally better. I mean, the cookie example I gave you earlier. The problem is that religion comes along and hijacks this deep need we have to get along with other people and to follow the rules. And it gives us some rules that have nothing to do with who we really are. And so that's where I'm seeing it. I don't think there's any evolutionary evidence for this at all. I don't think you can be an evolutionary psychologist and say, oh yeah, that's why. I think it's a pretty culturally based thing, and it's based in our need to get along with other people, and religion just comes along and hijacks that. Religion has hijacked a lot of things in our culture. And my first book, my third book rather, God Virus, was subtitled How Religion Infects Our Lives and Culture, because it does infect in places it doesn't need to be. You could take religion totally out of our culture, and our culture would be nothing but better, as we can see in Sweden and Denmark and places that has very little religion. So it's, I don't think you're saying, I'm not sure if I answer your question or not, but that's the way I see it.
At the outset of a particular organized religion, did they sit around like, how are we going to get control over our club?
Yeah.
Make them guilty about sex?
Well, about 600 BC or so, maybe 1000 BC, the religions really started working. I tie it back to patriarchal systems. Religion simply came along and used what patriarchy had already invented. So, and I look at a lot of patriarchal societies pre-Christian, pre-Judaism. And if you look at how patriarchy oppresses women and controls women for the to make sure you know who the progeny is and control the property in the second and third generations, well, then that explains a whole lot. But then religion comes along, Christianity and Judaism, Islam, Buddhism, Hinduism, all of those are patriarchal religions. Don't let anybody tell you Buddhism isn't. And they simply took over that function. And guilt is a big part of it. Shame is a big part of it. And that's why I write so much about shame. And there's, how do we get rid of that in this culture? So, yeah, I'm sorry, I didn't go. I had the answer, but I didn't understand your question as well. Yeah, oh, okay, yeah.
A question that would be of interest to many here. In your hierarchy that starts with the Mormons and the Seventh-day Adventists and slides down into the Catholic, where would you rank Judaism in there?
Well, we like I said, we looked at 27 different religions, and it's just people who responded to us. It's an online survey, so it's not random. And we didn't have a lot of Jews. I think we had like 100 former people who are no longer Jewish. And what we think was happening, we didn't get any Hasidic Jews, we didn't get any Orthodox Jews, we got Reformed Jews, we got people who were very liberal to begin with. So in our research, the Jews came out pretty low on sexual guilt. But we had the same problem with Muslims. We had 120 Muslims in our sample. Well, that's not very many, and they came from a wide range of places, and some were Sunni, some were Shia, some were other things. So we really can't generalize from either one of those samples. But I will say this, do you know who the lowest guilt religion was, and they were even lower in guilt than atheists? Any guesses? Unitarians, right. If you are a Unitarian, go get our report, you will love it. Show it to your church, fellow church members. What we found was Unitarians have this great program, OWL. It's age-appropriate sex ed, science-based sex education for children. I did not know this before I did my research, so I'm totally blind to this. And I said, shit, you use even better than we are. I'm an atheist. I should be more less guilty than you guys. But what I didn't know was they had this great program. Now, as an atheist, you don't have any place to send your kids for good science-based sex education. So that's one reason to go join the UU church. I don't have kids, so I don't join you guys, but I do like UUs. They're great people. Yeah, over here.
I don't know how to word this question, really, but You talked a lot about sex and how we feel guilty, but what about sex with minors? As soon as a female hits the reproductive age, which can right now be as young as 13, 11 years old, is that a secular thought, or is that, I mean, can you speak a little bit about that?
Well, I think we live in a very different culture than Jesus did. You know, they were marrying people off at 12 years old. In Muhammad's time, Muhammad had a 9-year-old wife. I don't see how you can have consent within our framework and our culture. Adult consent's not even possible until you're like 18. So the first rule of thumb is it has to be consensual. So that rules out any kind of... It's very arbitrary. I agree. I agree. I'm attracted to 15-year-old girls. I mean, who isn't? I'm not going to deny it. The fact is we have a legal system, and there's legal ramifications. I don't see that changing anywhere in the future. I think we live in a different culture than they did. And having babies early, because you only live until 30 years old, was a pretty bit important thing back then. We got other things, other considerations now. I mean, education and how much a child burdens the female more than the male, and how difficult it is to get an education when you're trying to nurse a baby and stuff. I mean, there's considerations that, you know, whether it's secular or not, they're reality. So, no, I'm not denying that we're not attracted to young people, that lots of people are. But whether it's consensual, that's my key. If it's not consensual, and it can't be by definition. And 18 is arbitrary, I had no doubt about it. Hey, I was having sexual relations when I was 16 years old. Today, I guess they put you in prison for doing that, but you know, that was just what was going on. When I was a kid, virtually everybody in my Sunday school class got pregnant or got somebody pregnant at by 17 or 18. I can't tell you how many people in my Sunday school class got married very quickly, and it wasn't 9 months later they had somebody. But that was the culture I grew up in, and I avoided that even somehow. I knew how to use condoms. Yeah. I don't know if that answers your question or not. Okay, yeah, over here. Go ahead.
So people are born gay, and then you have that distribution of the states with the gay porn site searches. Doesn't that sort of imply that shame causes gayness? I don't know if that's, I don't think that's funny, but I...
Yeah, can't argue with that logic, can we?
Interesting.
that's a good question. And it's actually addressed recently by a set of research that just came out recently. I don't know if you have read about that. Some researchers gave men, and in this case it was always men, a test to evaluate their homophobia. And so now they've got a paper and pencil test that kind of establishes what the level of homophobia this male is. Then they put the male on a plethysmograph. Does anybody know what a plethysmograph is? It measures your sexual excitement. It kind of like is a blood pressure cuff over your cock. So anyway, so then they flash pictures up on the screen and see which of these pictures stimulates the fellow. And they did this for many, many men. And that what they found was the more homophobic you are, the more you respond to gay sex pornography. Is this a surprise to any of us? I don't think religion or conservatism or homophobia causes homosexuality, but I think you're repressing. We all have some interest in a wide range of sexual activities, some of which may include, even if you're straight as the day is long, you still may think, hey, a guy looks pretty hot once in a while. I kind of like to guess if a guy is hot to my girlfriend or not. I'm a lousy guesser. What I think's hot, she doesn't, and vice versa. But, you know, it's kind of a fun game. I see some guys that said, man, if I was gay, I'd be in bed with him in a heartbeat. So we all, as Kenzie said on his scale, you know, his 1 to 7 scale, we're all somewhere on that scale, and very few of us are on the 1 or the 7 side, probably. Yeah, okay. One more question over there. Jerry, we need to go?
I just thought of something that I think is important, and that is what causes extreme pedophilia. I mean, is that from the repression of the church or what? And a film has just been made about this. I think it's called The Silence of the Church, and it's about pedophilia in America and how everyone was saying it was only in America, and he found a place in Europe where it's all over the world.
It's all over the world. Yeah. You're right. You're right. Well, I don't know that we know precisely what, quote, causes it. But I do know this. When you tell a priest they can't have sex with anybody, they're probably going to express it inappropriately. I had two experiences as a clinical psychologist with priests driving hundreds of miles just to see me because they didn't want their bishop knowing what they were doing. They show up in my office. I do, you know, counseling session with them once a week for a month or two. And the farther we got into this, and they described to me, and I'm really attracted to X, Y, or Z, and everything they told me sounded perfectly normal. And so at the end of a month or so, I told both of these guys, ultimately, everything you told me sounds like a perfectly normal 13-year-old boy. Yeah, you're a 45-year-old man, but you sound like a 13-year-old. So in other words, they're sexually stuck, developmentally arrested at 13. Now, I'll tell you what was going on with me at 13. I wasn't screwing girls because no girl would look at me, right? I couldn't find anybody. So what did I do? We had a lot of homosexual play in the locker room. There were four boys in my family. We played a little bit there. We played with neighbor kids. So there was lots of homosexual play going on at that age, at that time in my life. I don't think I'm probably out of the ordinary. I'd rather imagine a lot of guys in here had a similar experience because you're just learning about your body and you're stimulated and it doesn't take much to get a 13-year-old boy hard. So that's probably what was going on. And do you think about that? Okay, you take a priest. Most priests are already on the priest track by the time they're 13 or 14. And in some families, they basically designate. You're the designated priest. It used to be that in a lot of Irish families, you know. So I think you've got a sexually arrested development among priests. So what are they going to do with that? Well, they're probably going to do what they would have done at 13 years old. That's just my theory. I can't say I'm an expert in that area or that I have the final word. That was one guess. What causes the rest of it's a lot of other reasons. There's a lot of reasons why people fixate. And I talk a lot about that in Sex and God. Why do we fixate on this thing? You know, why is this person interested in big breasts and this person's not interested in, you know, big breasts or small breasts or something? Why do people fixate on different things? Why do they have fetishes? Almost everybody has some kind of a fetish. But there's reasons, but I don't know all the reasons. I just know it happens. And we explore that in the book a bit. All right.
We have one.
Did
last,
Stephen have a question? All
one
right.
Last question here.
Our psychologist is going to ask me a question. This is intimidating now.
I am a psychologist. I was a Catholic priest that you referred to, one of them. I was not, am not a pervert. I do enjoy sex, and I respect tremendously the dual program that you guys have developed. And I really appreciate it so deeply that I encourage all of us to be generous as we contribute to that big jar out there on the corner, because Darrel and his operation is going to get that. And in fact, I'm so excited about both the counseling program and your meetup groups that Diane and I have agreed, even though it's a larger crowd, we talked about doubling everything that you give and pledge.
Whoa.
And I have stationed at each door a youngster with pledge card with blank 3x5s. If you didn't bring your checkbook with you, or if you didn't bring enough cash, I would like you to take one of those 3x5 cards. Be sure to put your contact data on there if you want a receipt for tax purposes, because it is 501c3. Also, you put it in the jar. That will automatically label it that it's not Free Thought Arizona money. It's RR money, Recovering from Religion money. This, folks, these people, if we can make this go national like it should, like it deserves to on its merits, we can convert the world to our way of thinking. Okay? Now, Diane and I didn't realize there were going to be this many people here this morning. So we said, okay, we'll double everything that they put in there and the pledges that are fulfilled during this tax year, up to $5,000. Now that the crowd is bigger, we will raise that to $10,000.
Oh.
We will double In other words, when you put your 20 in there or your 50 or above or below that, whatever you decide to pledge and or give, as long as that pledge is fulfilled in this tax year, Diane and I will double it up to 10 grand.